I feel more comfortable. I feel less exposed. And at this time, I think I'm not really ready to sort of emerge altogether. I feel as though the glasses protect me from revealing my emotion too much, because something is showing there that is still very sad. People think that I'm outrageous, you know. Outrageous.
Who is this outrageous person? She's an artist whose career spans three decades. She began as a classical pianist, went on to become a recording artist, and to experiment with new sounds. She has also been a filmmaker, a poet, and a record producer. But for 14 years, Yoko Ono was best known as the wife of John Lennon. And he professed his love in public from the day they wed to the very day he died. Lennon's love made Yoko one of the most famous women in the world, yet people know almost as little about her today as they did in 1968 when John introduced her to his world. Some still see her as a dragon lady who stole him from the Beatles. Lennon claimed she was his source of strength and sustenance, but even to the man who knew her best, Yoko remained an enigma. And John Lennon captured her mystery in this portrait. Perhaps nothing has been as perplexing as Yoko's artworks. Sometimes self-indulgent, but always powerful. John Lennon once said, "Her pain is such that she expresses herself in a way that hurts you." One critic said she pushes pain into a liberating energy, like a stutterer giving birth to a difficult word. What links all of her work is its honesty and raw emotion. This song is a primal scream for a daughter she lost 12 years ago during a custody battle.
I'm not very good at sort of expressing myself in real life. I'm just too awkward and shy. And one of the reasons is because I'm always frightened, you know? And this fear is something I'm living with, you know, not sort of a tangible fear, but, you know, like just this feeling in the stomach or something just before you take exams or whatever. That kind of feeling all the time.
It's getting cold around here, people living in fear.
It helps to sort of, I think, hum a few tunes, you know? It's that feeling. Life gets easier when you're just sort of humming, you know.
You know my feeling? Yeah. That ending is so... That ending is so predictable in a way. Dun, dun, dun. Could we just try it like this? In other words, end of E.
Yeah, I'm a very normal person with normal sensibilities. Basically, you know, my background is a very sort of quiet kind of, let's not make waves kind of background. Yeah.
Oh,
Her name in Japanese means ocean child, and she was born in Tokyo in 1933, one of three children in a wealthy and respectable banking family, with old-fashioned ideas of tradition and female subservience. Her grandfather was the founder of a banking dynasty, and he amassed a multi-million dollar fortune before an assassin took his life. Her own father was a kind but remote figure, a fast-rising executive preoccupied by business. He left for San Francisco before Yoko was born. For years, her only sight of him was this photograph. Yoko's mother, an aloof woman, taught her daughter to hide her emotions. Mrs. Ono enjoyed her affluence, but had little time for children. Whatever money could buy, though, Yoko was likely to get. Piano lessons at the age of three, servants and nannies who became her only friends, and vast gardens where a little girl could get lost.
I was always sort of trying to beg people to play with me. Whenever I need a playmate, I buzz and say, "Could you call somebody to play with me?" And they say, "Bob is available. You know, he will be in 10 minutes.
As a founder of the Bank of Tokyo, Mr. Ono and his family shuttled back and forth between Japan and the United States, and in the process they became almost completely westernized. Settling first in San Francisco and later in affluent Scarsdale, New York, theirs was a life of privilege and cultural assimilation. Tutored in everything from Buddhism to the Bible, Yoko's life was a constant swing from east to west.
I went through a series of changes so rapidly, but I kept on adapting, and in fact, that is my whole life. Every corner I turn, the whole world changes, you know?
Her world changed abruptly with the outbreak of World War II and her family's forced return to Tokyo. In 1945, American planes destroyed the capital with incendiary bombs that left it burning like Nero's Rome. 83,000 people lost their lives. More than a million were left homeless. The rich were not immune to the hardships of war. When the Ono family emerged from their bomb shelter, the tragedy became real. And the enormity of the disaster took its toll on Yoko in a personal way. Separated from her parents, she was evacuated to the countryside along with 8 million others and faced starvation. She learned a way of dealing with hardship that has remained with her since.
I think the only way that I survived was to always think about something beautiful. And the beauty was not so much around me, but, well, around me in a realistic sense. But the nature was beautiful, sky was always beautiful. And the stories that I made up were all beautiful. I mean, I was writing fairy stories, you know? And I was in that world, shall we say. And I'm sure that many people do that, and many people have done that in their lives, you know, about sort of daydreaming. And daydreaming has become a form of life for me in a way. And sharing that daydream became my art, you know.
Her family hoped that she would become a classical pianist, but she was a rebel with her own ideas of art and music, as Yoko's former piano teacher, Augustine Sirota, recalled.
My pupil, everyone who knew she as a child would tell that there's a big talent who will be expressed sometime in a different way.
Yoko found that different way in the world of avant-garde art. Lower Manhattan during the 50s was a world of smoky cellars and freestyle jazz. An anything-goes world where Yoko, with her own free-flowing style, felt right at home. She had returned to New York to study music and philosophy at Sarah Lawrence College, but she rebelled against the tame conventionality of her home and school and dropped out. She married a Japanese pianist and joined a group of daring artists who were up to something radically different.
Anyone who is interested could come up on the stage and try to fly off from these ladders.
By the late 1950s, Yoko had already made a name for herself in Manhattan's avant-garde circles. Long before the big world would know her as the wife of a Beatle, the avant-garde knew her as a creator of happenings. Those improvisational events attracted mostly other avant-gardists who were intent on proving that there was a little bit of artist in everyone.
The piece I'm doing for you now, I think, for me, is her greatest piece.
For 20 years, Yoko's works have influenced generations of performing artists like Charlotte Moorman. In Cut Piece, viewers are invited up to snip off pieces of the artist's clothes. Yoko created Cut Piece during the 60s as part of a great tradition of informalizing art, taking it out of museums and asking spectators to share the creative role. Today, Cut Piece continues to shock audiences. Critic Mario Amaya recalls its first impact in 1966.
Cut Piece is certainly one of Yoko's most extraordinary and imaginative creations. I remember very well when she first did it. We all, a crowd of us, got on a train to Liverpool and went into this darkened auditorium where she sat very still in a beautiful black dress on the stage with a pair of scissors laid out before her, almost like a samurai sword. And it seemed like hours before anyone had the temerity to come onto the stage to snip one little piece of her dress off, which was the point of the exercise. And then finally another person came, and then another person, and another person. And it was just amazing. There was suddenly a rush to the stage, which she said was rather frightening. But it was very exciting for all of us. Another piece she did at the time was create a lot of black bags, which we were instructed to get into whenever we felt paranoid on the street. And we could be nobody. We could just be ourselves and hide our personalities if we wished. These things were very new, I have to explain, and in 1966, and it revolutionized for many people the entire concept of what art should be, how it could be poeticized and acted out in this particular way.
As laughable as they looked at the time, black bags were a serious attempt to get people involved with art in a personal way. Yoko experimented with various art forms, including a book of instructions she called Grapefruit. Part poetry, part put on, it showed her Zen influence. Her works were mind games that the viewer could play by filling in the piece with his own imagination, like this blank canvas on which anyone could have a go. One critic said she slows down minds that are going too fast and makes you look at everyday reality in a different way. Some called it concept art. Yoko preferred the title con art, which better reflected the humorous nature of her work.
This whole huge object actually may not be here. This whole show may not be here, you know. Or I may not be here, actually.
Well, I didn't feel anything.
Too dumb, too stupid. Mm-hmm. They didn't understand me, mm-hmm. you know. So it was a kind of arrogance. Uh-huh. So I was sad and I was unhappy because I can't communicate. They didn't understand what I understood.
But John Lennon understood. It was Yoko's art that brought them together at a London gallery in 1966. He found her preparing to show works like this painting to be stepped on. She found him eager to play her mind games.
I just thought that it's nice for people to step on a painting and sort of make their natural mark.
No respect for art, then.
Well, you know.
First he came to the Syndica Gallery,
yeah.
Show that I had of my sculptures and paintings.
Yeah.
And at that time, it was almost like a Zen meeting, you know. It was really funny, yes.
I heard about this. There's going to be this Japanese chick in black bags down at the art gallery. It's going to be a happening.
Whoa.
So I went down the night before the opening. And everything, when I got there, everything was white. White canvases, white this, white that.
Mm-hmm. There was a piece called ceiling painting.
Yeah.
And there's a painting on the ceiling, you see.
Yeah.
And my idea was for people to climb up a long, long ladder, just go on climbing up like this, you know. And
I walked up this ladder, and I picked up a spider, I did balance in there, and I seen teeny little writing, it just said yes.
Yeah. And that's the first piece he saw.
Yeah.
And he says now that if that said no instead of yes, you know, he wouldn't bother to see the show anymore.
most of the art those days was art that put everybody down, you know, like make people upset.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So I was anti-art because I'd been 5 years in art school and they're all phonies, you know, and I really was against it. But because it was positive, it said yes, I thought, okay, it's the first show I've been to that said something, you know, warm to me.
And then he came downstairs and I was there, and then the gallery owner just told me, you know, this man wants to hammer a nail in your hammer nailing piece.
And she says, no, because it wasn't the opening. She wanted to keep a nice clean board for the next day.
I didn't want him to do it because it was so white and so beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And it was still a virgin painting. You see, nobody hammered a nail in yet, you see?
Yeah. Well, she says, okay, well, give me 5 shillings then to hammer a nail in. That's about a dollar, you know, more than a dollar.
I decided $5 charge, or something.
So I said, listen, I'll give you an imaginary 5 shillings in and hammer an imaginary.